As the Vice Chancellor of the University of Sheffield, I was delighted to be asked to introduce the 1997 Faraday Lecture. It's particularly appropriate that the University of Sheffield be given this responsibility in 1997. For this year, we are celebrating the centenary of the foundation of University College Sheffield. One century later, here we are, a thriving, research-led institution with a very, very strong international dimension. Today's lecture is the product of a successful partnership between the Institution of Electrical Engineers and staff at the University of Sheffield who are engaged in leading-edge research into modern magnetism and its applications.
165 years ago, Michael Faraday discovered electromagnetic induction. Working at this very desk, he could not have conceived the effect his discovery would have on mankind. Even today, how many of us truly understand our dependence on magnetism? Apart from gravity, it is the single most important force which shapes our lives. We now depend on it for health, wealth, and entertainment. We're still learning about magnetism in its various forms and finding new ways to use it to improve our quality of life. To sustain the advancement of science and apply the knowledge we gain, we will constantly need imaginative engineers. As president of the IE, I hope this lecture, given by the University of Sheffield, inspires young people to consider a career like mine in electrical engineering. I hope you enjoy the lecture, which is called, "But What's the Use of It, Mr. Faraday?" Who knows? One day, one of you may come up with an answer no one else has thought of before.
Is our home. Seen from space, it appears as a gorgeous blue planet lit by the sun. But the dark side is also lit with lights from the world's cities. And those lights mean life. It's an inhabited planet. And life includes activities like driving this go-kart, using a credit card, or tying a knot in a piece of steel. Now we'll come back to these later because they all have something in common. Magnetism. Michael Faraday's great discovery was how to use magnetism to make electricity, electromagnetic induction. But what's the use of it, Mr. Faraday? Is a question he was often asked. He didn't really have an answer. His usual reply was, "Well, what's the use of a baby? Someday it will grow up." Well, his baby certainly has grown up from early laboratory experiments using simple equipment. 160 years of development has led to our electric world. And today, we're going to look at some of those discoveries and see how they've been developed and applied to such an extent that we often take them for granted. But our story starts with magnetism itself, without which there wouldn't really be a life at all. The Earth's magnetic field stretches far out into space, protects life on this planet from harmful solar radiation. Electrically charged particles continuously pour out of the sun. It's what we call the solar wind. If the Earth's magnetic field disappeared, then the solar wind would destroy the ozone layer. Radiation would eventually kill us all. But fortunately for us, the Earth's magnetic field repels the solar wind. Now, the region in space in which the field protects us is called the magnetosphere. On the sunward side of the Earth, it's squashed by the solar wind. But on the opposite side, it's drawn out into a long magneto tail, stretching well beyond the orbit of the moon. Within this protective zone, we've evolved. I mean, without magnetism, we just wouldn't be here at all. But a more familiar use of the Earth's magnetic field is for finding our way using a compass. Now, early compasses were made from lodestone, a naturally occurring magnetic iron ore. Now, the Chinese were using compasses from before 200 BC, made from slivers of lodestone, resting on a bed of loosely packed straw. Later, they developed magnetized steel needles, and then more elaborate bowl and spoon compasses. Now, here's a model of one. And the handle of the spoon here points to the pointer of the whole spoon. And interestingly, it's actually pointing to the south. And the Chinese used the south as their pole of reference, as opposed to our use of the North Pole. But iron ore and steel aren't the only materials that are magnetic. I mean, something we come into contact with even more frequently is the very air around us. And of course, most of air is nitrogen. So let's see what happens if we pour liquid nitrogen through the pole pieces of a powerful magnet. We've got liquid nitrogen in this flask here, very cold, of course. If we now pour that through the pole pieces of this magnet, well, not a lot happens, really, perhaps as you might expect. I mean, it falls through, boils away. But something a little more vital to life is oxygen. So let's pour liquid oxygen through the pole pieces of the same magnet. If you look carefully between those pole pieces, as liquid oxygen is poured, it stays there. It remains suspended by the magnetic field, because liquid oxygen is magnetic, until eventually it too just boils away. Lodestone isn't a very strong magnet. Liquid oxygen's not exactly convenient. So what sort of permanent magnets have been used over the years? Well, this one dates from the 1780s. It comes from the Shaw Magnet Company, established by Hannah Shaw in Sheffield in 1783. Now, the story goes that Hannah's brother Jack was in the Black Swan pub one night having a beer, as you do, and he met a traveller from Birmingham. Now, the traveller had been drinking a little too much that night, became very talkative, and out slipped the story of how to magnetize steel. Now, the idea is that a steel bar should be stroked across the top of a large magnet like this, and eventually the steel bar itself becomes magnetized. Now, with this knowledge, Hannah started her company. This is one of the two master magnets that the firm used to make all of the magnets that it ever made. For two centuries, it was locked away in a hidden cupboard, made known to only one or two people at a time. From these early days, magnets have evolved that are much stronger than the original ones. And while they're considerably more expensive than Hannah's type of magnet, they do allow problems to be solved in a very novel way. I mean, for instance, this very small, high-frequency loudspeaker is made using magnets 10 times smaller than usual. And this is the kind of device that it replaces nowadays. The advantage is that it could be placed in the center of a lower frequency drive unit, like that. Both the high frequency and the low frequency sounds appear to come from the same place, so it improves the stereo effect. Now we can demonstrate how effective are modern magnetic materials with the help of our first volunteer. Come on in, welcome. Come around here so we can all see you. Now, thank you very much for volunteering. What's your name?
Simon.
Simon, brilliant. Now, Simon, on this stand here, we have three different types of magnets, each of them supporting a basket, okay? Now, we want to really show the different strengths of these magnets, so what I'm going to ask you to do is, in turn, place these weights, I mean, they're bags of sugar for convenience, We put them into the baskets. We count how many bags it actually takes before the basket drops off, okay? You can go around the front there and start off with the first one on this side. That's it, thank you. This is a normal sort of metal magnet, similar to the Hanna type of magnet that we had. Okay, I bung them in and we'll see what, see how many it takes. You count them. So, that's two, yeah, three, keep going, four, brilliant, stop for a minute, thank you, four. So let's put four into the computer and we'll have our first result come up on the screen. Now you can see we're plotting these as a kind of bar graph. The horizontal axis represents each different magnet type, while the vertical axis represents the weight each can support. Okay, Sam, let's go for the second one. This is a ferrite magnet here supporting this second bag basket. Off you go. You count them in as I'm talking. Ferrite magnets were developed in the 1960s as a way of trying to make something a little stronger than the original metal-type magnets. How many have you got so far?
Six.
Six. Okay, keep going. Seven, eight. Lay them straight. Nine, ten, and go on. 11, 12. Keep going. 13, thank you. Okay, so 13 is our second result. There you go, ferrite magnets, significantly stronger than the metal magnets. Okay, now Simon, the final one. Might have put two at a time here. These are really the most modern type of magnets that we have, made from rare earth materials. And if you remember your periodic table, rare earth metals are the elements that come towards the very bottom of the periodic table. Fascinating set of elements in their own right. Keep going, Simon. How many of you do you have?
14.
14, keep going. Give you a hand if we run out. 16, 18, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 24, should we say for that one, because I put two in, 24. So the third and final result we're going to have here, the rare earth magnets managed to support 24 or so bags of sugar. Simon, thank you very much. Give him a round of applause for that. Something you can see from this very simple kind of demonstration, really how we've gone on as times have improved by developing the materials that we make magnets from. The ferrites were considerably stronger than the original metal magnets, and now these rare earth materials really can be so much stronger than the original ones that we had those years ago. We can see how effective are modern magnetic materials.
The magnets used in the experiment and the other ones you've seen earlier on were all examples of permanent magnets. Once magnetized, they stay that way. Sometimes, however, it would be better to be able to control the magnetic force, make it larger or smaller, turn it on or off. How this is done was actually discovered quite by chance in 1820. Professor Ørsted was lecturing in Copenhagen on the subject of electricity. Now, prior to this, it had been thought that electricity and magnetism might be linked, but no one had actually demonstrated it. Professor Ørsted was using an electrical battery in his lecture, and he noticed that whenever he turned the current on, a nearby compass needle moved. And when he turned the current off again, the needle moved back to its original position. So he realized, right there and then, in the lecture, that the electric current passing along the wire was actually generating a magnetic force. He had discovered one half of the electromagnetism riddle. Now, luck was with him, for as was said at the time, he had tumbled over it quite by accident. Electricity creates magnetism when current flows in a conductor. Now, later on, it was found the effect could be enhanced by simply winding the wire into a coil. And then it was found it could be made stronger still by having a steel core inside that coil. Doesn't sound very much, does it? In fact, it was a very important discovery, because scientists no longer had to rely upon very weak lodestone or those large steel magnet assemblers, such as the one that came from Shaw Magnets Company. They didn't need these now for their experiments. They could use electromagnets. These were very powerful, but were quite small in size. They soon began to be used in industry and commerce. Here is an example of a simple electromagnet. It consists of a battery, a switch, and a coil of wire around a steel bolt. Now, without any current, there's no force. If I turn the current on, I can support a That's the air block. And if I turn the current off, sometimes I can catch a 20 force. Let's see how that works. Now, when the switch is closed, current flows in the circuit. It goes through the coil, and that generates a magnetic field. This field spreads out. It links with the steel block, and there's an attractive force. So the block is pulled towards and held to the electromagnet. When the switch is opened, the current stops, so the field disappears, and so does the force, and the block falls away. See if I can do that once more. Ah, that's it, and it's that time. Now, if we want to support, say, a larger steel block, we obviously are going to need a much larger force. Now, what's nice about an electromagnet is this can be achieved quite easily by having more turns on the coil, more current through the coil, or indeed both. There was a third consequence to Earth's discovery, and that was, in fact, a race. And that race was between scientists to see who would be the first to discover the other half of the electromagnetism riddle. Could electricity be generated from magnetism? Now, amongst these scientists was Michael Faraday. He started out at the Royal Institution as a chemist. In the 1820s, he was working on the chemistry of metals. With James Stoddard at the Royal Institution, they had created silver steel. And in fact, they'd used chromium to make the first stainless steel, something like almost 100 years before it was widely used. But Faraday was, in fact, very excited by Oersted's discoveries. And he thought electromagnetism so important that he actually went as far as resigning many of his links with industry and commerce in order to concentrate upon his research. Now, this work culminated in quite a dramatic series of experiments between the 29th of August and the 28th of October, 1831, in which Faraday conclusively proved that electricity could be generated by magnetism. And continuously. In so doing, he actually closed the circle of knowledge on electromagnetism, which had been opened by Oersted some 11 years earlier. Now, what was it that Faraday had actually discovered? What was Faraday's principle? Well, he found that in order to generate a voltage in a circuit with a magnetic field, then that magnetic field must be changing. Now, it could be a change in the strength of the magnetic field through the circuit. It could actually be due to a movement between the circuit and the field. But whatever happened, there must be some form of change. We can demonstrate that here. I have a large magnet in front of a single piece of wire. Connected across that wire is this sensitive voltmeter. Now you can see the magnet and the needle are both at rest. There's no voltage being generated. As soon as I move the magnet, however, past the wire, you can see the needle moves. I'm generating a voltage. If I move the magnet continuously, the needle swings back and forth. I'm generating an alternating voltage. But it doesn't matter where the magnet is. If it's stationary, there is no induction, no voltage generated. What I like about this experiment is, in fact, it's so very, very simple. But on the basis of this principle, literally the whole of our electric world is based. Now, you don't have to have, if you want a greater output, you obviously need a longer piece of wire. And one way to achieve that is to wind the wire into a coil. And I have an example of that here, a long length of wire that's been wound into coils and put around the outside of this machine. In the center is a magnet. Now, when I turn the magnet, I can generate enough voltage and current to light the lamps in this small tree. Like that. There they are. Now, essentially, a power station is in fact simply a very large version of this machine. Now, you don't have to move the magnet all the time. You can, in fact, move the wire. Now, if space is no object, then you can don't have to wind the wire into a coil. Have a look at this video of a NASA experiment on induction carried out by the space shuttle 1996.
The tethered satellite drew out a long wire from the space shuttle. As the wire passed through the Earth's magnetic field lines, a voltage was induced across it, The cable was 20.7 kilometers long and should have generated 5,000 volts and up to 0.75 amperes of electric current. Unfortunately, it snapped before the experiment was completed. Future spacecraft could have some of their electric power supplied by trailing wires up to 96 kilometers long, producing as much as 15,000 volts. The amount of power will depend on the orbit.
The induction experiment was actually a great success because just before the cable broke, it was generating up to 4,000 volts. Oh, more conventional generators are widely available. For example, we have here an alternator from a car. It's used to keep the car batteries charged. Some bicycles have small generators built into the wheels for their lighting. This is rather nice. It's a little handheld torch, and it has no batteries in. It has a small dynamo, which is operated by the ratchet mechanism from the handle. You might be able to hear that working. This is an absolutely splendid invention. It's actually a clockwork radio. It doesn't need batteries or a main supply. What I have to do is wind up the handle. Should be quite good. I'm afraid the reception is very poor. That's because we're right in the heart of the Barbican Centre, and it is very difficult for the signals to reach us. But it's very, very useful in places where batteries are very expensive or the main supply is not easily available, it's unreliable. And one full wind of the mechanism makes the radio last for about 40 minutes. Now, our next example of a generator concerns an application which is not so familiar. And for that, we need the help of our next volunteer, Elizabeth. Elizabeth, welcome. What school are you from?
Mark Hall.
Yes, from Mark Hall. Is that Harlow?
Yeah.
Yeah, right. Now, what I'd like you to do is to hold that boot for the minute and take this match while I explain what's going on. Now, in civil engineering and mining, very often, large quantities of earth or rock have to be moved, and blasting is the best way. Now, blasting needs dynamite. Dynamite requires a fuse, and that fuse needs to be lit. This is where Elizabeth comes in. We've actually put the fuse through water, so it should burn out. Don't worry about it. Now, if you'd like to try, in best time-honored Western tradition, try and strike the match on the sole of the boot. Right, I tell you what, I'll do it for you, and you can light the fuse. There we are, a bit more used to it than you are. That's it, she's away. Now, I know in the Western films, you can get hold of the dynamite and very casually throw it. Of course, in real life, no one does that at all. It's far too dangerous. And what we use, in fact, is an electrical exploder box. I mean, who in their right mind really wants to be anywhere near a stick of dynamite with a lighted fuse? I certainly don't, for one. Actually, that reminds me that the exploder box is missing. Just keep an eye on it, will you? I'll just pop and get it. It must be here somewhere. It's here. Here it is. Left behind. Right, I'll just bring it out. Well, it was supposed to go out in the water. Come out of the way. Yes, well, that's a bit of a damp squib, that. Let's get rid of it. Okay. I'll just pop it in this bucket to make sure the fuse is properly burned out. I felt that. Right, well, as you can see, dynamite's very dodgy stuff. It's best to keep well away from it. So, this is where we have the exploder box. Now, if you'd like to pull the handle up, and then if you give it a big push down, that will start the animation, explain how it works. Now, on the handle are a set of teeth. They engage with the gear wheel. So as the handle is pushed down, the gear spins round. It operates a generator. A current flows down the cable to the detonator, and the dynamite is exploded. Now, all this is much safer. It's very remote. The cable can be several hundred meters long. Now, the thing is, this is quite an old one. It's quite heavy. You have to try lifting that. It's extremely heavy, isn't it? So in mining, for example, the tunnels might be some miles long, so we want something that's more portable. This is a modern exploder box. It was a working one lent to us by a mining company. And you can see it's much more portable. Using modern magnetic materials, the generators are more compact. Now, if you'd like to just show us how this works, Elizabeth, if you turn that handle until the little light comes on, that's it, she's charged up. Now all you have to do to operate it, to fire the charge, is just press that black button there. See? Right. Well, that's the exploder box. Now, would you like to give Elizabeth a big hand, please, for her very explosive performance in the Faraday lecture? Thank you very much.
Perhaps we should now turn to a quieter, more conventional use of electromagnetism. We saw at the beginning how the dark side of the Earth is lit by the world's cities. Well, electrical energy is something we have in abundance, something we really do take for granted. If you had to generate your own electricity, life would be very different indeed. So with the help of our next volunteer, it's a case of on your bike. Hi, now welcome. If you'd like to stand round here for me, please. Your name is Wazib. That's it. Right, now then, Wazib. Bicycle. But the rear wheel is really now a generator, okay? The output of the generator, we're going to measure and display in units of 50 watts by these bulbs at the side here. So, Wazib, if you can get on the bike, please, and start to pedal slowly at first, and we'll see what you can do. Okay, now gradually speed up. That's it. Go a bit faster. 100 watts, can you do a bit more? 150 perhaps? Any more? 200? Almost. 200, we just got 200, brilliant, keep going. Right, okay, 150, maybe 200 watts. About a tenth of the amount needed for an electric kettle. Wazib, you fancy a job? We could pay you 2 pence an hour. I mean, that's how much it costs to buy that amount of electricity. So you can see that really pedaling away like that, 200 watts for any length of time, is pretty hard work, isn't it? I mean, compare this with our modern power stations that produce 2,000 million watts continuously, 365 days a year. Okay, but there's another problem with this do-it-yourself electricity generation. Have you heard of voltage stabilization? Let's have a look, Wazib. Hang on for a minute. What I'm going to do is set this. So we've got 150 watts there. Now, if you can pedal, there are 3 light bulbs at the side. Now, that's right, a green bulb at the moment. If you pedal too slowly, the yellow bulb lights up. And too fast, try going a bit faster. We'll check the top bulb. Yeah, the red bulb lights up. So if you can pedal, now try and keep the green one lit. This indicates that Wazib's giving us an output of 240 volts, and the usual UK mains voltage. Now, keep pedaling. Now, if you can try and keep that green light on, Wazib, what we're going to do is do something like turning on more lights in a house. So if I increase that load to, say, 300, 400, 500 watts, poor old Wazib slows down, the voltage drops to the yellow, and it's pretty tough to bring it back into the green. Okay, Wazib, thank you very much. I can give him a round of applause for that. Well done. Keeping a voltage nice and stable is not easy. I mean, generating that amount of electricity in the first place is no mean thing to do. It's rather like I'm trying to watch television. Can you imagine doing that with a pedal or cycle generator like this? You need a whole relay of pedalers to take over when each one became tired. And then when you turned on the kettle to make a cup of tea, you wouldn't have enough power left for the television. But with modern-day power stations, our electricity is convenient, widespread, abundant. Something Faraday would well have appreciated, living in an era lit by candles and oil lamps.
I mentioned earlier that induction can occur with a change in magnetic field strength. This is the basis of a device called the transformer. Now, the first one was built by Michael Faraday in August 1831, and it consisted of a round iron ring with 2 coils wound on it.
I found that when an electric current flowed through one coil, a compass needle placed near a wire connected to the second coil moved momentarily. When I turned the current off, the needle flicked again. This happened every time the battery was connected or disconnected, but not when the current was flowing steadily or not at all. At the moment of contact, an electric current began to flow and increased to its steady value. Whilst the electric current was increasing, the magnetic field produced by the coil grew. This magnetic field passed through the second coil and induced a voltage in it, and a current flowed down the wire, creating a magnetic effect. When the input current was stable, the magnetic field was constant, so there was no induction. When the input current was switched off, the magnetic field collapsed, and the change again induced a voltage in the second coil, this time of the opposite polarity. I realized that the effect of induction only took place when there was a change in the magnetic field.
A modern transformer consists of primary and secondary coils wound on an iron core. Now, instead of switching the primary current on and off, as Faraday had done, a modern transformer has its primary coil connected to a source of alternating current. That's usually the 240-volt mains. The continuously changing current creates a continuously changing magnetic flux. This goes around the core, through the secondary coil, and induces a continuous voltage in it. Now, the advantage of a transformer is that by altering the number of turns on the primary and secondary, we can alter the output voltage. We can make it higher or lower than the input, as we require. For example, a power station generator produces about 25,000 volts. Now, using a transformer, this is stepped up to about 400,000 volts for efficient transmission over the national grid network. Now, this is another example of a step-up transformer. It's called a Tesla coil. Now, the primary has 12 turns, and the secondary, this tall column of windings, has in fact 2,000 turns on it. When the primary is driven by a very high-frequency alternating current from this special generator, we can produce up to 50,000 volts at the output of the secondary. Now, I want to show you what can happen there, but like all very high voltage equipment, it does actually depend upon atmospheric conditions, so I don't know whether it will strike or not. Let's see. You turn up the power. Ah, yes, it's gone. What we're getting is that discharge above it, those little mini lightning strikes there. What's happening is the voltage is so very high, the electric stress is so large on the air, it's literally tearing the air apart. Ions and electrons are flying in different directions. They collide with other gas molecules, and they produce discharge, which you can see there. It's what we call a plasma. Now, if I reduce the drive, we lose the discharge. I've dropped the voltage a little bit. But there's still enough output from that to light this fluorescent tube. What's happening is that a very small current is passing from the coil through the air to the tube, going down the tube, through my arm and body to Earth. Now, it's a very, very high frequency, and it's a very, very small current. It's not hurting me at all, otherwise I wouldn't be doing it. But don't try this experiment at home or at school. You can't do it at mains frequencies. You do need very special equipment. Now, if I climb on this platform, I can manage it without falling off, I'm insulating myself from ground, so the current can't flow there. If I give it another path, for example, the second fluorescent tube, I can strike two at once. Now, all that's possible because of the very high voltage generated by a step-up transformer. Now, another common transformer is the step-down variety, and this is where the output voltage is, in fact, much lower than the input. And I have an example here. The secondary, these two copper bars, produce 5 volts, but at 500 amps. This is for an input to its primary of 250 volts, or something like 10 amps. Now, coming from Sheffield, you'd expect me to do something with steel. So what I've done is connected a steel bar across the output. When I apply an input, we get a very large current flow. It's something like about 400 amps to start with, through that bar. It's obviously beginning to heat up. You can see it smoking there. What I'm going to do is try and let it heat up sufficiently so I can tie a knot in it, see how well I can do. You notice the fact that the current is falling. And that's simply because as the bar gets hotter, its resistance increases. So I can compensate for that by turning up the drive. I have to get the bar up to about 1,000 degrees Celsius. Takes just a little while to get there. It's coming up now. As it gets hotter, it will expand, so it begins to bow a little bit, and you also will see sparks flying from it when it's just ready for turning. It's not far off now, I shouldn't think. We should see the sparks quite soon. Yep, there they are. Right, I'll try and do this without burning my tie. I've lost several already with this. Right, I'll make the first loop like that, twist it round, and then make the second loop, and bring the end through the first, and then, whilst it's still red hot, it's quite easy to work when it's hot, just get it into a knot. I just use the anvil a little bit there. Some shape into it. Not quite. That's it. Right. Quench it and make it safe. And there we are. A knot in a piece of steel. Now, this is the basis of a device, a process called direct resistance heating, which is used in industry. They use much larger transformers and much larger pieces of steel, but they heat them up for prior to pressing or forging operations. But transformers aren't only used for heating.
And in case you're wondering what else the transformer effect can be used for, have a look at this next piece of video, which is getting doctors and surgeons very excited. What you can see on the large picture is a narrow tube called an endoscope being passed into someone's body. Now, an endoscope is rather like a flexible telescope. It enables the doctor to see what's going on inside the body. But the passages are full of twists and turns. It's very difficult to thread the endoscope into exactly the right position. And so that the doctor knows exactly where in the body is the tube, there's a number of coils positioned along the endoscope's length. Now, when these coils pass over primary coils underneath the operating table, a voltage is induced in these secondary coils. This voltage is fed into a computer. The computer generates an image on a screen, which is what you see overlaid here. And so the doctor knows exactly what's happening to the endoscope, where it's moving inside the body, and has a very good idea of exactly what he is actually looking at. Now, we've seen how voltages can be induced in wires using time-varying magnetic fields. Here's a variation on Faraday's famous experiment, using an air cord coil and an alternating current. Now, it's a coil about 100 turns, half a meter diameter. And here I have a single loop of wire connected to a large voltmeter. Now, because there's an alternating current being passed through the large primary coil there, as I pass this secondary loop over the top of that coil, the magnetic field created by the primary coil, by the current passing in the primary coil, induces a voltage in the secondary coil. And if I now reduce the area through which that magnetic field can pass, the voltage drops, bring the secondary coil back to increase the area again, and the voltage increases. Remove it from the magnetic field, and the voltage drops. But voltages can be induced in all sorts of conductors, I mean, not just in wires. My body is a conductor of electricity, although not a very good one, but it follows that a voltage could be induced, instead of in a loop of wire, in a loop made by my arms. So let's have a look. If I connect myself to the same voltmeter using these terminals here, we get a voltage. If I now bring my elbows together and decrease the area that the magnetic field can pass through, the voltage drops. I increase the area again, and the voltage increases. Now, this is all very useful because the signaling system of the body is electrical. I mean, sensory nerve fibers carry signals from the muscles to the brain to tell you what's going on, both inside and outside the body. So if I did something like hit my thumb with a hammer, then impulses would travel through the nerves from my thumb up my arm to my brain to tell me that my thumb hurts. And similarly, if I want to wiggle my fingers, motor nerve fibers carry signals in the opposite direction from my brain down my arm to my hand to actually cause the movement. But nerves can also be stimulated externally. Using electromagnetism. Let's go along to the Royal Institution. Here's Michael Faraday in his office. And we take a coil, pulse some current through this coil, put the coil on an arm. Now, the resulting magnetic field from that coil there induces currents in the tissue, stimulates both the motor and the sensory fibers. Signals are traveling in both directions, to the muscles and to the brain, causing movement and sensation. Now, it's not as easy as you might think to make a magnetic nerve stimulator. You need 3,000 amps and 5,000 volts in the coil to actually make it happen. So it's a neat piece of engineering. But I can demonstrate it fairly easily. I mean, here is a stimulator. And I've got a foot switch on the floor here. So every time I push my foot on the switch, the stimulator will fire. At least it will if I turn it on. So let's do that. We'll give it some decent input there. Now, I can show you the kind of magnetic field created by the current flowing through this coil here with the aid of this metal disc. Of course, the currents flowing in the coil create a huge magnetic field, and that magnetic field will induce currents in the disc. So look what happens when I actually do pulse currents through the coil. And of course, then, if I put the coil on my arm, I twitch. It even passes through clothing. I mean, you could say that magnetic nerve stimulators reach the parts of the body that others cannot reach. The brain, for instance. A magnetic field passes right through the skull. Currents that it induces stimulate the brain with ease. And this is very important because it means that you can then measure the speed at which impulses travel through the nervous system. Some diseases, like multiple sclerosis, slow down parts of the nervous system. So you can measure the speed that it's all happening. It's an aid to diagnosis. And another use of magnetic nerve stimulation to treat depression also looks very promising. Engineers at the Royal Hallamshire Hospital and the University of Sheffield took 10 years to develop magnetic nerve stimulators, but now over 2,000 units are in use in hospitals worldwide. A valuable application of Faraday's electromagnetic induction.
We've seen how Faraday discovered that a changing magnetic field will induce a voltage in a circuit. Now, this has led to the development of generators and transformers, and ultimately to the power supply network that we know. This network is an example of a system whereby mechanical power from sources such as large steam-driven turbines or water-driven turbines, even windmills now, is converted to electrical power. Now, we've seen some uses of that electrical energy. It has medical applications. It's used in manufacturing to heat or to melt steel. It's used in lighting, space heating. Now, at home, we use it to power radios, TVs, hi-fis, and so on. But in fact, much of this electrical power is converted back to mechanical power through the millions of electric motors in use each day. And it's something like 40% of the power for Europe. It's a very large amount. Once again, it was Michael Faraday who made key discoveries in developments which led to motors. What is the basis of an electric motor? Well, if a conductor is in a magnetic field and it carries a current, it will experience a force. I can demonstrate that here. We have a magnet, and there will be a field between its pole pieces. Now, suspended in that field is this wire and two flexible supports. And when I pass a current through the wire, you see it will move. As I increase the current, it goes outwards under the action of the force that's generated, and then it goes back in again. Now, that movement on this is obviously quite limited. But Faraday, in 1821, produced a better design. The magnet was now at the bottom, and the wire was suspended from a pivot at the top. Surrounding the magnet was a pool of mercury, which acted as the bottom electrical contact for the piece of wire. Now, when a current was applied, the wire moved in a circle around the magnet. If the direction of the current was reversed, the wire moved the other way. The force was reversed. Now, this really was the first true electric motor. using a magnet, a conductor, and electric current to produce a continuous mechanical motion. Another early type of motor, which was in fact more practical than this one, had the moving wire replaced by a rotating disc. There was an electrical contact on the axle of the disc and a second one at the bottom edge. When current flowed through the contacts, went along the axle, down through the disc, through that part of the disc where there was a magnetic field, out to the bottom contact. We have the three elements, therefore, for a force: a conductor, a current, and a magnetic field. And the resultant force caused the disc to turn. Now, engineers were very quick to see the advantages of this sort of invention, and over the years, many types of motors have been produced of all shapes and sizes. We have very, very tiny motors producing less than a watt of power, for example, in our watches. And it ranges right up to the huge machines used in industry, producing tens or hundreds of kilowatts of power. But even after all these years, new machines are still being developed and new fields of application are being found. Now, one of them, which is having increasing importance, is that of electric vehicles. Now, the idea of electric vehicles certainly isn't new. They were around well beyond the turn of the century. In fact, this bullet-shaped electric car was the first vehicle of any kind to go more than 100 kilometers per hour. No one knows in which direction it was going, but it was going more than 100 kilometers per hour. Although the electric vehicle showed early promise, in fact, it was the internal combustion engine which eventually took over as the main form of vehicle propulsion units. This was because electric vehicles needed batteries. They were large and they were heavy, and they gave only a limited range and performance before they needed recharging, which took a long time. Drivers wanted convenience. They wanted to travel further and faster, and so electric vehicles never caught on as a means of personal transport. The situation is now changing today, and most of the major car manufacturers are in fact developing electric vehicles, such as the EV1 here. This is produced by General Motors and is now available in some states in the USA. The real reason for doing this is because of the desperate need to reduce pollution in inner city areas and in city areas. Now, as a means of enhancing the image of electric vehicles, and also as test beds for new ideas in drives and circuitry, we at Sheffield have developed two new electric vehicles. The first one is this electric go-kart. Now, this was developed as a racing cart, and this one has actually had to be considerably detuned, because if we hadn't have done, it would have shot straight across the stage, in fact, into the front row. But I've got to be careful myself, it goes quite quickly. Now, this cart has as its power source a new type of motor called a brushless DC motor. And this uses rare earth magnets in the rotor. We saw those magnets demonstrated early on. These are very powerful, give a very high power-to-weight ratio, which is necessary for a light machine such as this. It uses nickel-cadmium batteries. And there are two battery packs in these black boxes, one either side of the driver. Now, they have enough charge to last for about a 20-minute race. It takes something like 30 minutes to recharge between races, which is fine for the sport. Okay, thanks, Claire. Now, an electric cart, very quietly and smoothly, outperforms the standard indoor petrol engine cart and without any of the exhaust fumes. That's a major advantage for the sport of indoor karting. Now, a second example is built around the framework of what was a Formula 3000 racing car. Now, the concept was to convert it to an all-electric vehicle, but with the same performance as the original. Now, this meant, with a circuit such as Silverstone, that's about 2.5 miles, it required a lap time of about 90 seconds, and it had to be able to last a 10-lap, 15-minute race. Now, here you can see the car before conversion. And then, when the petrol engine and the gearbox and drivetrain were removed, it looked like this after the installation of the electric drives. Now, those yellow pods either side of the chassis are, in fact, the battery packs. They're nickel-cadmium batteries, and there are 500 of them. They weigh about 500 kilograms in total. As you can imagine, the electric motors for a racing car would have to be very special. This car uses two of them. This one has a gearbox and has a motor and gearbox built into each of the rear wheels. The object on the right, the black object, is in fact the motor. These two are brushless DC machines using rare earth magnets in their rotors for a very high power-to-weight ratio. In fact, they are 10 times as powerful as the cart motor, but they're actually smaller in size. Because of this, so much power in so small a volume, they have to be oil-cooled. Now, unfortunately, the car is far too big to bring with us, but we do have a video of it in action.
Have you had a go yet?
No, they won't let me. I'm too old now. I've got too many grey hairs, I'm afraid.
But not all motors have to be as powerful as those. Underneath this microscope is a motor with a performance just as exciting as those in the car. It's made using the same kind of integrated circuit technology as computers are. It's a micromotor. It will ultimately be the active part of a gyroscope for inertial navigation or a car active suspension unit. Now, one of the problems of designing a micro-gyroscope is making a micro-rotor, something that spins around a disc, just being disc or rotor. One of the problems of this is trying to design bearings for it that neither wear out nor consume too much power. Now, the solution, it's obvious when you think about it, is make a rotor that doesn't have any bearings at all. And I can show you how it's done. And the base unit here is two small coils. Here's a metal disc, which I put over the coils. And if I now increase the power to those coils, see what actually happens to the disc. We can actually make the disc levitate. And of course, floating on air, it requires such a small push to start it spinning. There's very little friction to slow it, so it will just keep on going and going. That's the same kind of technology that's used in the micro-rotor. We've got a piece of video to show you in action. This is a real piece of video taken through a microscope. And with careful design of the lifting coils, a suitable pattern of electric currents passing through them, you can make a rotor that not only levitates, but also rotates. Now, ultimately, this will have to spin at thousands of RPM for the necessary gyroscopic stability. But what you're looking at here is a rotor that's only half a millimeter in diameter.
We've seen how Earth did discover that a magnetic field is created by an electric current. And we've seen how Faraday discovered how to induce voltages by changing magnetic field. Another unexpected use of these two principles is associated with the credit card. And we'll now see how that has developed. Now, Michael Faraday had only been working at the Royal Institution for a few months when he was invited to visit France with Sir Humphrey Davy in 1813. Now, this was actually at the time of the Napoleonic Wars. Sir Humphrey, Lady Davy, her maid, and Faraday were in fact the only free English people in France at the time. All the others were prisoners of war. Interestingly, it was Napoleon himself who actually signed their permission to visit. He was a great patron of the sciences and an admirer of Davy and his work. Now, money was required for their trip, and it certainly wasn't sensible at all to carry a lot of gold with them. They needed the services of a bank. In fact, all travellers need money. Look at these two, for example.
How on earth did we end up with this heap?
Just get the bags, boss.
We'll never make that plane, sir.
Nonsense.
Our carriage awaits.
Right, we need some cash.
Barclay card? You're not in Macclesfield now, boff.
So, both Faraday's party and our two friends are a long way from home. Now, they're 180 years apart, and they both need money. How did they get the money then, and how would they get it today? Well, in 1813, Sir Humphrey Davy would almost certainly have carried letters of introduction and credit. Now, these were letters written by his bank manager saying Sir Humphrey Davy was a man of honour and creditworthiness and asking the French banks to extend their facilities to him. Now, 180 years later, the worldwide credit and debit card service of today appears very different from that of Faraday's time. And yet, in a way, they are very similar. We use a plastic card instead of a bulky letter. A banker or shopkeeper could contact a home bank or credit house to get authorization to release goods and services in another country. But all of this, however, happens almost instantaneously. And there are tens of millions of transactions each day, not just a few per year. But how's all this come about? Traditionally, the banks offered services based around buildings. The staff went to the bank, and so did the customers. The services offered all needed processing, and it was the processing that dominated the system for very many years. Every transaction involved paper, and all this had to be moved around physically. There were millions of checks and credit slips going in and out of banks, shops, clearing houses. The whole financial system proceeded at the pace of the paper, and it couldn't, in fact, go any faster. It was the magnetic stripe on the credit card and electronic processing that actually liberated the financial services industry from paper. Computers, telephones, and ultra-fast and very reliable data communication systems have revolutionized the banking system. Let's look in more detail at the card. All credit and debit cards throughout the world are in fact made to a common standard. So in principle, any card from any bank can be used anywhere in the world. Now, on its face is the embossed data, which you can see is still used for the diminishing number of paper transactions. On its reverse is the magnetic stripe. Now this stripe contains numerical data up to about 40 digits long. This describes the account number, expiry date of the card, and something called a service code. The data is put onto the card by moving it past a small coil, which is very similar to the recording head of a tape recorder. An electric current is passed through the coil. This generates a magnetic field, as Ørsted showed, and that field magnetizes the stripe. Now, the current is pulsed on and off as the card is passed through in line with the data. So each track on the stripe consists of a series of magnetized and unmagnetized regions. When the card is placed inside the cash machine, it's moved past a detector head, which is very similar to the playback head in a tape recorder. Using Faraday's principle of induction, a series of voltage pulses is induced in the detector as the magnetized stripe passes the coil. Now, these pulses contain all the card data, and they're then encrypted for security purposes. So, now let's see how all of this works for our two friends who are stranded in Mexico. They've got a card and they have a machine. Put the two together and the process can begin. Now, because they're in Mexico, their data is sent to a central Mexican bank. Now, this realizes it is an international transaction and not simply a local Mexican one. But it sends all that information to the main North American clearinghouse in St. Louis, Missouri. Here, it's recognized as a European card, and so that information is passed to MasterCard's European handling network called Europay, which is in Brussels. Here, it's recognized as an English card and a Barclay card, so it's sent to Barclay Card in Gloucester. The data is decoded, and the account number, expiry date, some other security checks are all carried out. If the transaction is authorized, then the signal goes right back through the system to the cash machine in Mexico, and it releases the money. Now, all this takes between about 5 and 10 seconds, and about half of this is actually spent in the encryption and decryption for security purposes. Now, just to put all of this in context, let's repeat the whole sequence again, but in real time. We'll start off again at the cash machine. We put the data in, the system's away. To actually operate the system is just about the same time as Rowan Atkinson takes to remove his hat. And all this has been made possible because of the magnetic stripe and the ability to write characters on it and read them from it electronically. It's replaced all of these rather bulky letters of credit. But things aren't standing still, however, and we now have the smart card. This, in fact, uses a small computer chip, which, in fact, is housed under that connection pad which has just appeared. Now, this chip contains all the data required for banking, and, in fact, a lot of other data can be stored as well. On a credit card, you have a very miniature and very personal PC.
Now, all of these things we've been talking about today weren't developed overnight. When Michael Faraday first demonstrated his electrical discoveries, he had no idea the uses to which electricity, magnetism, electromagnetic induction could be put. And his was the age of water power and steam. But for Michael Faraday, his work was not simply a job. Science, experimentation, discovery, they were a passion. He spent his whole life exploring the natural world in which he lived. And scientists and engineers have taken Faraday's original ideas, applied endeavour, ingenuity, innovation, to create the world in which we live today. But what of the future? Where will tomorrow's engineers and innovators come from? They will come from you. Like Michael Faraday, perhaps you will make a discovery or an invention, the effects of which will echo down the centuries, benefiting future generations and worlds to come.
What is certain, however, is that many engineers and scientists will continue to find new answers to that old question. But what's the use of it, Mr. Faraday?